also have a proud privilege to have Dr. Tara S. Nair among us. Let me give you a brief profile introduction of Tara Madam as well. Having completed MPhil and PhD in Applied Economics and Economics respectively from the Center of Development Studies, Trivandrum, affiliated to Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi, Dr. Tara S. Nair has worked on the faculty of Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, Gujarat, Institute of Development Research, Gujarat Institute of Development Research, GIDR, Mudra Institute of Communications, Ahmedabad, which is popularly known as MICA, and Institute of Rural Management, Anand, popularly known as IRMA. Between 1993 and 2007, she accomplished all these assignments. Before starting her second stint at GIDR in 2009, she had headed research at the Friends of Women's World Banking, FWWB India, for 2 years. Dr. Nair's research mainly concerns issues in policy and institutional development in the areas of pro-poor financial services, rural innovation, women and development, and livelihoods. She has contributed to the discourse on Indian microfinance since the late 1990s through research studies and policy critiques. Particularly, she has looked at the connections between the moral, social, and economic aspects of the working of microfinance in the country. She has co-authored the book and several research reports in the sector of microfinance since 2013 and before. She was also part of the Inclusive Finance India report of 2014. She has also edited a volume of essays edited Microfinance in India, Approaches, Outcomes and Challenges, published by Routledge India in 2015. Currently, she focuses on two areas of research. One is understanding the gender implication of the new and emerging institutional arrangements that have gained currency as part of the process of restructuring of rural and agricultural economy, and two, the implications of financial sector reforms and financialization of household economies. She has been an erudite researcher in terms of social and development research. Recently, she has a visiting scholar at the Foundation Maison des Sciences de Home Paris under the Indo-French Program of Cooperation in Social Sciences between April and May 2016, and at the Media Management and Transformation Center, Jönköping International Business School, Jönköping University, Sweden, during May and June 2016. This was the brief round of introduction for our guest. May I request all of you to kindly give a huge round of applause to them for sharing their time with us.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think I was pretty impressed by your participation in the morning. I thought the questions were extremely relevant. I really like the question of the co-working space, you know, how to distinguish between an incubation center and just a place to co-work and all that. So I must also thank the college management, because I think this is pretty unique kind of an initiative coming from a quote-unquote college. You know, where you think that the business is to teach and, you know, like produce as many numbers as, you know, as many numbers of graduates or postgraduates as possible. So in that sort of a, you know, current scenario that, you know, you thought in terms of having an interaction of this nature is absolutely wonderful. I must congratulate Father you and your efficiency. I was in touch with Ritwik and Sudesh now, you know, these days. So I thought, I come from a social science background. My kind of 25 years of my life has almost completely spent in research, but for some few breaks in teaching and research, which I enjoy, but then I realized that that is not giving me enough space for research and publication, so I just went back to pure research now since 2009. But I really understand that there is a great link between research and teaching, because research-based teaching is much more enjoyable than textbook-based teaching. Having said that, I also believe that research is not an activity. Like, you know, research is something which you do in intervals of teaching. To me, research is a culture. Research is an attitude. And research is in some ways a way of life. You know, it's about a very continuous process of asking questions, trying to find answers, making sense out of them, trying to understand or trying to discover a method to answer those questions. And some of these activities all of us would be doing even in everyday life, but we don't recognize that as research. When you talk about academic research, we are systematizing that, and we are kind of creating a kind of, we are trying to find out the philosophy behind doing that activity. That's when it becomes a grand sort of a research design. So I'm sure all of you are, you know, the ones who have done your PhD must have definitely gone through the drill of, you know, methodology and, you know, like how to write a proposal and, you know, what do you mean, what is a research problem and things like that. And who aspire to do or are planning to do their PhDs should know that what is essential is to sort of, you know, awaken that questioning individual within us. That's exactly what research is. It's almost like truth seeking. That's why much of the philosophy of research is actually all about what is research. So research is all about, we say philosophically, we say that it is actually trying to bridge the gap between what we know and what is knowledge. We know is not what knowledge is. Knowledge is something else, it resides somewhere else, it's quite external to what we know. But a researcher's kind of, you know, travel is always towards bridging that gap. I know something about this particular phenomenon, but I know that that is not complete knowledge. Let me just find that out. So that is, I think that urge is, I think, is perhaps everywhere. That could be in religion, that could be in, you know, academics, that could be in research, that could be in our normal everyday lives. So in that sense, I think all of us are, you know, researchers already. It is essentially the challenge is to kind of systematize that energy of inquiry and seeking answers into a kind of a system so that we can do it scientifically, as they say, you know, as scientifically as possible. But having said that, we would also kind of acknowledge that in order to do this kind of a systematic truth seeking or knowledge seeking, we need conducive environments. In all environments, it cannot happen. Very often, teachers can fall far behind in research because they are busy teaching all the time. And in the current times, I understand, you know, like one of the professors of strategy who have published wonderful research in the past, I asked her, why is it that you are not really publishing anything? She said, I am just going in and out of classes now. So where will I get time? So when we want to kind of encourage research in faculty, I think we should also think in terms of what kind of a facilitative environment that the system can then provide for you know, that kind of research. I don't think only faculty are you know, are part of that. I consider students are very much part of that environment. And undergraduate students are very often much more enthused and much more innocent than when they reach their kind of, you know, masters and beyond levels, where, you know, their aspirations must have been much more well formed and things like that. So a lot of, you know, that's why if you look at some of these very so-called effective kind of, you know, overseas universities, undergraduate publishing is a very interesting activity. May not be very fine, complete, finished pieces, but they encourage younger people to ask questions and find out some answers. There will be some effort to edit that kind of, you know, kind of a thing and publish it. I think St. Joseph's College, Bangalore has an undergraduate publication thing, because my daughter was studying there and I saw her one little article, which was a very immature article, but it found a place in an ISBN journal. So I think one of the things I thought was that for the students to be more actively participating in our kinds of work would be to really start something like that. It doesn't always need to be printed these days. It can be an online thing. It can be a digital kind of a thing, etc. I just sort of, you know, jumped into that because I thought, you know, like that is something which is very easily doable in this place. I also think that we have to be very realistically aware of the context in which BSSS or BSSS. I say BSSS because we have a Center for Social Sciences in Calcutta which we call as CSSS. You know, so I think to me BSSS becomes much more, you know, easy to say. So there is a context in which this institution, this college is kind of, you know, located. That is the social, physical, cultural, academic context of Bhopal or Madhya Pradesh. I don't think we can circumvent that very fast. So the plans that we formulate, to me, should be kind of, you know, conditioned by the resources that we have and the ability that we have at this point in time. I will not say ability, the capability, I think in a very Amartya Sen fashion. The capability and entitlements that we have in terms of putting those resources together. So I think that is that should be at the back of in our mind when we think in terms of what is feasible to promote research, to promote a culture of research, etc., etc. I must also say that social science research, or let me include even something like management research. When I say social science, I would also include a discipline like social work. There are many challenges right now which come not from the local context but from the macro context. We know that research has actually now become a very utilitarian activity. I do research because I get promotion. I do research because I kind of get an increment. Not because I do research because I really want to fly high in the world of knowledge, nothing of that sort. That phase is perhaps even, I think that is also the creation of maybe the way in which maybe our UGC has created its, you know, regulations and rules and kind of, you know, approach to research, etc. So we are definitely under the kind of under the threat of research being sort of co-opted by utilitarian elements rather than pure epistemological concerns about, like, you know, push the boundaries of knowledge. I fortunately come from a generation where we all have spent maybe more than 5-6 years on campus not doing anything, very often without fellowships. Not even, you know, we did not even know what kind of job are we going to get, but we were so passionate about finishing that piece of work. And nobody really pushed us out of our hostels, and hostels were completely sort of, you know, like subsidized. Khana was subsidized. Nobody asked us anything. So that freedom of sheer pursuit of knowledge is completely gone. I think there was great advantage of that kind of an experience, because we had actually leisurely time to really sort of, you know, pursue a lot of things. Now the students who eventually, if BSSS becomes a kind of, you know, an institute which offers PhD degrees, you are not going to give your students that freedom. You will insist that you just get a PhD degree and get out in 3 years, finish a coursework in 6 months, finish your proposal in 6 months and get out into it. So I think we need to be a little more realistic about what is possible in the current, and to me that's a great that's a great challenge and threat to kind of research activities. But my understanding about social science research is slightly utopian, because that's what shaped my you know, engagement with research. There's also, as I told you, serious sort of, you know, challenges to creating research capacity and culture in institutions like this, teaching institutions like this. One is the burden of teaching would be very high. I can actually presume that. You all must be teaching very hard, you know, like trying to kind of, you know, not only teaching, then invigilation, then evaluation, then marks and attending to students and a whole lot of things. And of course, in many institutions, not maybe this, is also, you know, one of the constraints is the commitment of the leadership. You know, maybe there are a lot of aspiring kind of researchers, but the leadership is not very committed to that. I see a lot of such institutes in the state that I come from currently, that is Gujarat. You know, there are departments with one teacher. I am actually currently heading a kind of, you know, guiding a postdoctoral fellow, a very bright one, but he is a commerce teacher. His undergraduate college, he is the only teacher in the department. He is teaching all the papers to the undergraduate students, and he is doing a postdoctoral now. So the if you really go to the kind of, you know, he told me that if I go to the principal, he says that what is the use in having a postdoctoral? He does, first of all, he said he did not even understand when I say PDF. You know, for us PDF is a PDF, you know, like not a postdoctoral fellowship. So that is the kind of environment in which many of our institutions are kind of working. But once I think BSSS is at that stage when you have realized that maybe research, you know, and those kind of capabilities are extremely important for the institution to grow. If that state of kind of, you know, consciousness and kind of realizations had happened, I think the most important thing is to create an ecosystem which can nurture, facilitate, promote and reward research. You know, younger faculty members always complain that, you know, we have published a paper but nobody really sort of, you know, took notice of that. Nobody values it. They say that you're not teaching, what is the, you know, so there is a kind of rewarding those efforts is extremely important. I'm not talking about even a kind of external material monetary reward, but some form of acknowledging the fact that somebody is a good researcher, has produced a good piece of work and things like that. And what are the main components of the ecosystem is what I can really perhaps talk about from my own experience of over 2.5 decades, drawing from maybe some of what some of us are doing. One important aspect of that ecosystem is frequent debates. No researcher survives in isolation. You know, again, that is one cultural factor we are losing very suddenly. We are all kind of, you know, happy in our own little rooms and cabins and a computer and a mouse and, you know, like, we are very happy. And of course, the world outside is open through the web, kind of internet. So, but without debate, without talking, discussing, debating, disagreeing, we will not be able to do good research. There is no doubt about it. You know, so that is one. So creating a culture of debate. There are various ways in which one can actually. I remember my master's days, my department had what was called as a Thursday club. Every Thursday afternoon, the master's students got together. I remember once I was discussing Small is Beautiful by Schumacher. Nothing, you just read it because you are excited about it, you go and talk about it, somebody comes, listens to it. It may not be always very crowded, maybe 2, 3, 4 people, whoever is willing, come, listen to it, create, you know, make a comment on that, and a couple of, you know, maybe about 1 hour of discussion. And but that really kind of, you know, creates wonderful sort of an energy within you. So create that kind of an institution where, and try to kind of, you know, sort of, you know, institutionalize that. Have a student teacher kind of, you know, sort of a forum, an informal forum, where you can read an article in a good journal, come and discuss that. You can actually discuss a socially kind of, you know, useful film. You know, I would say that our generation learned much, much more from listening to others than reading by ourselves. And our seniors used to discuss all kinds of things, you know, though we are students of economics, we used to have, you know, theater discussion, we used to have film discussion. Discussion, what is discussed is not important. The method of discussion is very important. The fact that you are interacting, you are kind of, you know, you are presenting, interacting, debating, questioning, that is what a researcher needs. So that's a skill set. It's not like, now, you know, we are very worried about the fact that, you know, sometimes students come and ask us, you know, ma'am, I know this data envelopment analysis, it's a kind of an econometric method. Could you give me a problem? So the only concern very often now is actually what I know some method, I'm not interested in the issue. I think research starts with issues. You know, your ability to identify, understand, and sort of, you know, like deconstruct something as an issue, and then try to kind of your ability to talk about it, talk among ourselves, present it, counter it, defend it, offend it. That's research. It's not writing 2 paragraphs of good English. It's not research. So that, in order to get that sort of a discursive kind of a discipline, I think it's important that we create institutions, some informal institutions of debate, discussion, seminars. Seminars are extremely interesting kind of an opportunity. Somebody will, today morning when somebody is talking about incubation center, I'm least interested in incubation as an activity. But engaging with incubation and activity is a very interesting enterprise. You know, you start asking questions. That's why you got so many questions. So my point is that this exercise that is happening right now may be institutionalized within BSSS through some kind of a little informal forum, and we should be willing to share our views about it. So listening to others is another interesting element in the ecosystem. There is, in research, there is no one truth. At least social science research talks always about multiple truths. Your truth may be different from mine, but your truth is also equally valuable as my truth. So, and I think that is the kind of philosophical foundation from where I come from. I believe that truth is socially constructed or culturally constructed. So I think listening to others would give us, maybe awaken us to the possibility of, an alternative possibility. But at the same time, my possibility is mine, and I know why I have the possibility, because my logical system is different from your logical system. So listening to others, engaging with others is extremely important component of a research ecosystem. And what the management can do would be to create that kind of thing. There should be a system of faculty seminars. And we should not think about my problem is not profound. Every problem is profound in this country. You know, so we should be able to present little seminars and create a kind of a system for that. Every month, one faculty seminar, somebody will come. And I think the other major threat to research is this strict hold of disciplines. I belong to economics, I belong to sociology, I belong to political science, anthropology. Though we talk about interdisciplinarity, we are hardly interdisciplinary. So research becomes much more enjoyable when we try to cross disciplines. So anthropology must converse with economics, economics must converse with political science, and political science must converse with management. And commerce generally stands somewhere else. Commerce must converse with literature. Isn't it? There are interesting literary documents which can really lend a lot of insights to the commerce faculty. Isn't it? So that these are all very easy. For me, it's very easy to sit at this side of the table and say. But I think these are not impossibles. You know, like it is only a kind of a sensitivity that you develop towards other disciplines that's all what we need. So this rigid disciplinary bounds must be deliberately broken, and especially in a smaller place like this, when we are meeting everybody all the time, it's always nice to talk across. I think that thing is also very important as part of a research friendly ecosystem. And publications, I am not talking about publications in world journals or first rated global journals. I am actually talking about working papers which are preliminary results of some of your analysis, can come out as a working paper series, which are very interesting. And if you make that working papers peer reviewable, send it to us, people like us, who have very humble understanding about the world of research, I can really suggest an army of such people, who are willing to lend time and resources to read something of that sort. So let's have a peer-reviewed working paper series. And a working paper is not a 12,000 word document. A working paper can be about 4,000 to 5,000 words. But write that, and it's a working paper, so nobody is going to take you to task saying that no, your results are tentative and your conclusions are questionable, because it is still an evolving document. So, but when you start doing it, there will be a coordinator, there will be a process of editing, there will be a process of review. You know, there will be some synergy which happens, there will be some conversations happen around that. The other important element would be your participation in seminars. It doesn't matter whether you have a completely written paper or not, because many of the seminars which are done in this country now really accept papers which are in working stage. Why do we go to seminar? Seminars should not be seen as the place where you preach to others. Seminars are wonderful places where we pick up a lot of ideas. And seminar is one occasion where you actually would be able to find out the status of your own discipline in one go. You know what others are working on, what is current in my field. You can bring it to the class and, you know, there will be very interesting discussions in the class then and all that. So you must look for, you know, seminar announcements. And a journal like EPW is extremely good. And EPW, Economic and Political Weekly, is not one discipline's weekly, it belongs to everyone. And they always sort of publicize all the major national seminars and conferences in that. Make it a habit to look for them. Send your papers and abstracts, and I'm sure if you send 3 abstracts to, you know, these conferences, one would be definitely accepted. You must travel to that place, meet others, you know, see similar faculty members in similar situations and all that. The other thing would be to create at least a kind of a conference or seminar series in every 2 years or 3 years, whenever it's possible. Then you can actually bring a lot of people into this institution. You know, like a lot of, you know, researchers can then visit this place, know this place. No, it is not very easy to just strike collaborations, let me tell you that. After working maybe about 1.5, 2 decades, we cracked the code of collaboration. So when we start to do research, we should not believe that somebody just will come and just collaborate with us on research. It's not going to happen. And it will take time. It will take time, more than time, it will take actually some amount of effort on our side. Since conferences, seminars and all that are very important events when people come to know of us. And if you really kind of, you know, announce that kind of an event in a good journal like EPW or whatever, then people would also start looking at this BSSS as a name, isn't it? So I think one of the things that maybe this institute should plan for the coming 2 years would be to have a good cross-cutting thematic seminar. We can, again, you know, people like us can really help you who should be invited as resource persons and who would really would be valuable to you and things like that. So that also is important. And as I told you, I don't know, I think I would also say that a review of curriculum from a research point of view would also be important. I know that you have a large number of certificate courses, but maybe you should also have research-based electives, wherein the faculty member has a great interest in one area, have done some work, you know, environment, ecology. I know that many of you would be interested in those kinds of things and have done some core sort of work in that area. You can offer about 15 hours of lectures. I think there should be electives based on research output. And I think youngsters would lap it up. I can tell you that. They're also looking for, you know, classes which are beyond all this textbookish knowledge, you know, where they can talk and discuss and debate. And many of them would be really bright. I can actually tell you, from my own little experience of teaching. So, curriculum and involvement of students in some of your activities would be extremely important. And I think I should not behave as if I have really sort of, you know, resolved all the issues about research, but I am really trying to sort of, you know, pull together a large number of things I have experienced, I have seen in my teaching life. When I was teaching at Institute of Rural Management, Anand, I did not ever handle a mainstream course. That time I was working on rural innovation issues. For 7 years, I ran an elective course on rural innovation and nobody questioned that. And students really liked that issue, and that was a completely kind of presentation, kind of, you know, case-based, maybe 1/3 of theory and the rest of the practice and case-based theory, and it was really very interesting. So the institution never asked me, why don't you teach microeconomics and microeconomics? So that sort of a freedom should perhaps be available to the faculty members, so that will be purely research-based. You know, you can really bring in new knowledge, you can talk about contemporary issues, you can really bring to the notice of students what is happening around this around the world. The real thing which comes to my mind is actually ecology and environment, which is very, you know, very hot in some sense. So this issue of, and I think somebody raised about this non-profit organization, not-for-profit organizations losing their kind of in a relevance and ground because of, you know, that's an extremely interesting, you can actually have a wonderful elective course on third sector, its relevance and role and constraints. So social work students who are poised to get into the job market would know what is the theory of this, you know, like third sector growth and decline and you know, stagnation and things like that. So those, so there should be some sort of a renewal of our own kind of, you know, like knowledge, our own interest, our own aspirations, which will then get formed as kind of, you know, these are all, I would say, very, very research based. I'll finish within 5 minutes, and then I would rather like to have a more of an interaction. I know that it's not very, it's very interesting to keep people captivated in the class, but being in their position is not very interesting, which you are doing now. And of course, at the personal level, I think I'm talking about ecosystem incentives, let me put it that way. But there are a lot of personal level kind of, you know, factors too, which I think, unfortunately, mainly due to the lack of encouragement or lack of understanding from the larger macro system as to what research is, slowly disappearing. Critical reading. Internet reading ko finish kar diya. It's gone. Libraries are sitting like archaic. The libraries are archives these days. You know, to what some extent I also understand that if knowledge comes to you kind of digitally, virtually into your own computer, there is no need for us to, but I think it is always nice to, I think this is also, I'm saying this also to pass it on to our own students, that walking into a library, touching a book, feeling a book, smelling a book is a very different experience. There was a time when we used to actually sort of, you know, identify journals by the color of the first front page. World development, we never use world development and the red wala, you know, front page, you know, it's visual. And we exactly know in the JNU library where the data is kept, in which shelf, maybe the NFHS data is kept and which. I'm not romanticizing that, but I'm just trying to say that it's a very interesting skill of, you know, physically sort of, you know, experiencing knowledge. So that is something which we need to kind of rediscover, and we need to encourage students to kind of, you know, doing so. Seminar courses where you ask them to come and read, give an article, ask them to come, somebody would, you know, all that is possible. I think these are small micro steps, but they all would add accumulatively to a kind of, you know, interesting environment. And as I have already said, that writing, and I think we must write, and you know, we must write, and we must have a forum to put those writings for somebody else to read. So working paper is what I would suggest. And kind of, yeah, reading, writing, critical reflections, revising the writing. Nobody writes, nobody's first draft is final. You know, I think as many revisions, the more the revisions, the better the paper's quality. And those revisions, if somebody else, you send it to someone, someone's views are taken, then actually it becomes much more kind of a thing. So there are certain tacit skills a researcher acquires through the process of research, which cannot be taught, which need to be learned. Nobody can teach these skills. We must learn them to our own kind of thing. So I would also believe that the other important value with respect to research is respect for diversity. And in one way, I would say that transdisciplinary, interdisciplinary sort of an interest would be a kind of a proxy for diversity. Suppose we organize a seminar or a conference 2 years from now, I think one of the sort of, you know, points that we have to have in our mind is that we will bring in as diverse a population as possible. Now what I see is that that is also my generation's problem. Like, you know, I will call my friends and relatives and I'll do a conference. And that is really happening. And some conferences have only Odias, because the organizing secretary is an Odia academic. Or only Bengalis. Or only Malayalis. And these are the three, you know, I know of. So I think it's deliberately making our engagement diverse is very, very, very core aspect of, you know, knowledge creation in, kind of, you know, and research. Yeah, I have written like debates, disagreement, diversity and discursive processes. These are, you know, all these, somehow all of them started with these. But, you know, all these will perhaps make a process of research very, 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 very interesting. Yeah, but the last point I would actually say that all this must be done realistically with the context of Madhya Pradesh in mind. The moment we do that, I can tell you there are enough resources around in the state who can collaborate with us. Maybe we have not looked for them because there was no need for them to look for them. There are enough resources in the state which we have not tapped yet. You know, maybe when it comes to that, I would be able to also name a couple of them. So suppose, you know, like we want to, BSSS is going to do a research program. When you say a research program, there are multiple research projects within a program. A research project is one project, but maybe the school can actually start in terms of a research program wherein different disciplines and individuals can come with their own small sort of, you know, research projects, and that can actually be submitted for funding. And I'm sure, I think we'll think about it when it comes to that. But it's actually possible. And there are enough issues in Madhya Pradesh which very, very urgently requires kind of, you know, research analysis and solid systematic data and information. So I think this context must be very much core to our engagements is what I would actually say. What are the institutional gaps in Madhya Pradesh with respect to a whole kind of, you know, gamut of issues, health, education, you take anything, you know, non-profit, profit sector, businesses, health, education, you know, child nutrition, you know, you just name it. There are gaps and gaps and gaps in agriculture industry, just look at it. So I think we should be able to then come out with a comprehensive research program sort of an idea, which then can be pitched in the current management sort of jargon, you know, for funding. It's absolutely feasible. So let me actually stop here, and then if you have questions, I would be more kind of, you know, effective. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful lecture. Actually, we were waiting for a long time for this kind of discussion. You have almost addressed everything we were, you know, concerned about. So, when you started your discussion, your talk, I was sitting with four questions, but three questions you have already answered. So, I have one question remaining, that is, recently the ICSSR has advised or made it, you know, a compulsory for us researchers that make research relevant to policy, government policy, which is again like regulating the original knowledge creation. What do you think, like, in this situation, how we can go about the real knowledge creation, and in doing that, how we can attract funding?
Okay. I think we have to be clever now. That's how I look at it.
You know, researchers have to be exceptionally crafty and clever at this point in time. You know, it's extremely important for us at this point in history to convince the funding agencies, including UGC, ICSSR, ICCR, you take anything, that there is some utility of this research. I am actually doing a 2-year large funding project with ICSSR. After the funding, I received two questions. You tell us how your research would benefit policy and how your research would benefit society. My research is on financialization. That is actually the hold of the large finance capital and its impact on local economy levels. So if you really ask me, I really do not have great policy suggestions to give, but I thought I cannot do that. So that's when I start kind of linking for, you know, the purpose of that, you know, satisfying the funder, I linked it with what is happening in the case of financial inclusion. Fine. But my, what I'm doing right now in the field, to me, is a 2-year ethnographic study. I have not compromised anything with respect to the methodology. It is ethnography, and it is ethnography in its purest form for the past 1 year. So I would, my publications are definitely going to be in journals which are, you know, largely taking ethnographic research. But the report that I submit to ICSSR, I would definitely have a lot of policy suggestions. And who is looking at your suggestions? No one. Your report will go, a clerk would tick, report came. Report received, tick mark. That's all. And maybe the secretary, the member secretary will really look at your recommendation sheet at the end of it. Have a nice executive summary at the beginning where you add all that. And have a good conclusion chapter with recommendations. Your research is done. So that's what I'm saying. We have to be exceptionally clever, because otherwise I don't think we, this is also not the time for us to feel very dejected and unhappy. This is the time we need to actually be very active. It's almost like a sabotage, but I think it is important. So you also learn a little kind of, you know, street smart and street kind of, you know, yes, being street smart. And some tricks of the circus, that's all. It's almost like double entry bookkeeping. That's all. That's the only way we can survive. I completely agree with you. Actually, a working paper, this is the, I coordinate the working paper, so this is the 246th working paper which has come out, and 5 are in the pipeline. Because we do a large number of projects, you know, faculty members always have a tentative sort of a, you know, project-based write-up as a working paper. A working paper, in our case, we actually send for a review. And but the only thing we do is that we ask the author who the paper should go. If you send it to a journal, the journal would decide the reviewer. In this case, we'll ask the author, agar aapka kuch aisa preference hai kya. Then we give the reviewer about 3 weeks. That essentially means that we generally have a very close circle of reviewers. And we will pass on the comments to the author or authors and ask them, you look at these comments and incorporate what is feasible. So, but they need to kind of send us a little note saying that this is how I have addressed the comments. Sometimes they say that this question is irrelevant, so I did not address it. So we have no problem with that. We have an ISBN number which we just kind of got over the ISBN thing. So we have been allotted large number of ISBN numbers. It's an ISBN numbered kind of a thing. And then now we are only putting it digital. Otherwise, we had printed copies, and we have a large mailing list which includes all the institutions, most of the institutions in this country, all the ICSR institutions, some of the major researchers, and some of the university departments, where these go on exchange. We send it to them. If they have a similar thing, they can send it to us. It's all free. We write there 100 rupees, 40 rupees, and all that. Not a single copy we generally sell. You know, that is just to, because if an ISBN number is there, it has to be a commercial publication or something. So we just write whatever. There is a price page ratio. So we just kind of put it there. But we know that somebody in the website is making money out of us. You know, there is some aggregator who is actually collecting our working papers and GIDR book series karke. Somebody is making money. I don't know who. But we actually, because this is very much part of a very, this is very much part of a collective common effort. In fact, it is high time we put that there in the copyright. It's not a copyrighted material, it's more of an author's copyright. And the copyright actually lies with the author. The author is able to, and at least 2/3 of those working papers will get published, not in this form as a better form. So very often the faculty members take this as a kind of an opportunity to try out some of these things, and they will have two outputs. There'll be a working paper and a publication. I think that we used to put a star mark to against all the working papers, but now there are too many we are not doing anymore. So there is anybody can submit a manuscript to now. For the past 3 years, I am handling it. I do an editing. Then we send it to a reviewer. The reviewer gives comments. The comments get incorporated, and then it is composed in house and published, kind of printed outside. That's why. Look, every working paper is a single book. Every working paper has a single ISBN number. It's considered as a book in the technical definition.
Journals, which is an IESN number. ISSN,
yeah.
Now, does it guarantee that it's a quality, or does every ISSN number journal need to be peer reviewed or referred journal?
Technically, perhaps yes, but I think there is no guarantee of quality. ISSN, even now, you know that all departments are publishing journals with ISSN numbers. It's a simple application that you make, and you get allotted numbers. And now, I think very interestingly, you have to give the Aadhaar number. That's the only thing. I think we are stuck with that. Our director is not willing to give Aadhaar number. So I can get an ISBN. That's, it doesn't really guarantee anything.
So it need not be peer review or referred journal?
Not really. And very often the journals may say peer review. The peer could be you for me.
Okay.
Nobody is asking who is your peer. So that is a standard that you set for ourselves. Like, it is our practice for the past 20 years that, and in fact, in the annual report, we also publish a list of reviewers, just to make a kind of a statement to the world that these are the people who have reviewed. And very often they are Madhav Gadgil said, like, anybody could be a reviewer. We generally make it a point to send it to the best people in the field. Yeah. You mean the check for plagiarism? Yes. I think I want to talk about ethics. I somehow forgot about it. One of the larger issues of research currently is ethics issues. Half of it happens because of our lack of information, because we don't really know. Let me tell you that this, since we start with working papers, one of our faculty members who published a working paper on environmental issues, refined version of that, he submitted in Current Science. Current Science is one of the topmost journals in environmental ecological science. So I received a letter from the editor saying that we checked for, we did a plagiarism check, and it is coming about 80% plagiarized. That's because this working paper was online. It's available online. And many of the plagiarism checking website, applications, really do it online. So they actually found the same guy's working paper is already in the public domain. So it said, then we just issued a certificate saying that, this is a working paper, it's already published and things like that. But now we have made it a policy, if suppose somebody tells us that I have sent this paper for publication, and there's a likelihood of that coming out anytime, we only put the abstracts. And some of the working papers, even in our website, has only abstracts. That's because the author does not want to release the full paper before the publication comes. But plagiarism is a big issue. I have received books from publishers like Oxford, OUP, completely plagiarized. So there is a kind of an audacity among individuals to just go ahead and let me tell you another case of plagiarism. A young faculty member who was working in our department, in our institute in 2009, now he is working in Karnataka. He just recently wrote to me with one of his working papers, which I happened to edit, said that verbatim, that working paper has come out as a publication by a very respectable official in the economics and statistics department in Karnataka. What should I do? he doesn't have the capacity, he's very young, he doesn't have the capacity to take him on. And he says that this guy also visits the institute very often. And nothing other than two lines changed in the abstract, not a single word here, and it's a very data heavy paper. So I just went around and asked people, then, you know, like, I think these are some of the things we should really notice. When I looked at the publication of that researcher or that officer, it said some publishers Delhi. So I immediately went to, and he said some publishers in Delhi whose editor is a faculty of management in Kalyani or somewhere in West Bengal, University of Kalyani, I think. So I went to the website of the publisher first. Other than a contact address, there is nothing of that publisher. A Gurgaon address or a Daryaganj address of a publishing company. And then a series of names, about 100 names as associate editors. And with mushkil se I found the editor relevant to this publication. I went to Kalyani University's website, there is no one in there by that name. So we are living also in a, and I also got scared at that point in time. I thought I am actually trying to kind of, you know, sort of deal with some shady kind of, you know, group. So we have not resolved it, but I was told by Professor Naiji Idea that the author can write in the op-ed column of Hindu or some such paper, who encourage such kinds of, kind of, you know, just for public notice. Other than that, the damage has already been done. So it is extremely important for us to know where are we publishing. So there are a large number of online journals now, you know, there are, you know, Journal of Social and Management Research, Journal of Management Research and something, something, you know, you can't, you know, there are umpteen number of journals which come online. They are, most of them are very dubious kind of, you know, quality journals. I think one has to be extremely careful as to where are we publishing. I have a BSS has your own journals, isn't it? In-house journals. Every department has a journal. Yeah. Maybe upgrading the quality of those journals would be one thing we could say. Even inviting maybe one or two issues where you can have thematic issues, you invite people from outside to write in that, so that it can actually have gained some visibility. That's one interesting. Have edited, you know, a thematic kind of a volume. Every department can decide a theme and invite scholars from outside the college to contribute, and you know, one or two people can have a nice editorial piece in the beginning, introduction editorial, and that's how the visibility would increase. Ethical aspect of that is to publish more, you know, so that people cite you. But let me also tell you, there is a trick to that, in the sense that you start citing your own self. People do that. People actually do that. But impact factor journal, if you are looking at international journals, I think that's a great aspiration. You know, but it's a choice that one makes, in the sense that this is actually a very interesting debate. I think that opens up some other, let me just handle this question, in the sense that we should be able to, I think if you are interested in you know, having that sort of an impact factor, then you should first identify three or four international journals which are up in the top 1 to 10 ranking of your area, and just start writing to them, sending manuscripts to them. One good thing about that is that you get excellent comments from them. You know, the international journals give you wonderful comments, and they are very fair and extremely ethical in terms of, you know, they will definitely send it for refereeing. And if it's not publishable, the editorial desk itself will decide that, saying that, okay, you know, on the basis of the theme of our paper, maybe your paper doesn't fit in, but they will even tell you where to publish, you know. So that is one exercise I think everybody should do. Identify 5 or 10 good journals and start sending them, and journals are very friendly that way. The other thing would be that we should also, I know that it's a UGC obsession which we have not yet come to, that, you know, rated journals and impact factor and things like that. If you ask me, if when I write a very good article, I first consider APW. For me, readership is important. I want people to read my piece rather than I want to tell the world that I have a publication. So I think about 10 of my good papers have gone into APW. In fact, I'm very proud of that. But at the same time, APW in very many schemes is not a, it's a refereed journal, but its impact factor is high, but its rate is very low. Africa, if you look at Australian Research Council, they give it a some third kind of, you know, point or something of that sort. So it's a researcher's desire also, where do you position yourself? I consider researchers as public intellectuals, so I would actually like to be part of a public debate rather than publishing because, you know, I am noticed by somebody in Netherlands, though that is important. And I think APW would also give me that visibility. You know, somebody in Netherlands also reads my work. So, but if there's a compulsion of, you know, that thing, I think we must target our writing. So that is also a very interesting process because every journal will have its own style sheet, its own kind of, you know, some journals would be more interested in empirical papers, some journals would be interested in empirical plus theoretical papers, some people would not take without, you know, certain kinds of, you know, academic conventions. So I think that is actually an interesting exercise. Identify 5 or 10 good journals and do that. I also don't think there is nothing wrong in actually citing yourself. You know, not do that for the sake of doing it, but very often what happens is that we contribute. I think, let me also give you, these are the publication sort of things. I have my students who are in the US, who are in academics, they always ask me, why ma'am, why are you contributing papers to edited volumes? That's because, you know, many of these volumes are written by our friends and teachers and, you know, like acquaintances and all that. They will ask you, I'm editing a good book, will you just send it? We send it. But in the Western circles, edited book, the chapters in edited books are not given any importance. They are not considered for your promotion also. So many of us really waste a lot of our good pieces to these kinds of volumes. I think maybe we should reduce that and send those things to, you know, journals. So that is also one publication tip. But you publish books. But these chapters are not even, I think I realize that because ICSSR has asked us to kind of, you know, do all our scopus and, you know, like sort of things. So the local, you know, students can read it. If the classic textbooks are not translated and available, then, you know, I think then there is no, so maybe that is also a very interesting project. Yeah. Translation.
Exactly. Ma'am,
yeah. A lot of money in translation, if you put it that way.
Sorry, ma'am. Sorry. Yeah. Actually, this is what you are saying. I met a person from SAGE who, they are looking for people who can translate their work in Hindi and Marathi. And SAGE Bhasha has already started the work of translating all the good academic texts which are available only in English. They are actually come up with Hindi and Marathi and in Kannada also. Yeah. Right?
Well, I think that has to happen because you are really wasting a lot of intellectual resources in the margin because of our obsession with English. Source it, that's all. Nobody would say it is plagiarized in that sense. But suppose somebody has written a paper using a kind of, you know, or analyzing and processing RBI data and generated her or his own calculations and you can simply copy that is plagiarism. Even then, you can always say that source so and so. Very often we don't do that. So we have no right to lift somebody else's intellectual work. RBI data is an open source database. Anybody can use it as it is, but we must kind of, you know, at the site, at the bottom, you must write source RBI such and such a thing.
Different levels of academic. So we want to have an internal policy which we can
I don't think we should rediscover the wheel. We should simply look at one of the best ethical policies available online, make our own little, I don't think we should really write up a new ethical policy. There are wonderful ethical policies which others have already defined, but not the real foreign ones. The standards are extremely high and, you know, very often we will not be able to kind of match up to them. Any university ethical guidelines can be adapted to us. I don't think we should really spend a lot of effort and time writing up another policy. That's a waste of time.
Excuse me, ma'am. My question is regarding the student research, which you tell earlier.
Pardon?
Students research, which you tell earlier. The research by students.
Students research, yeah.
So my question is that, madam, since I'm from science background,
yeah.
So can we convert students research into skills and then into information? My question is that, can we convert students' research into skills and then into information? Because suppose I am having 40 students, then it is not possible all the 40 students to go for research.
Right.
Some may go for skills.
Absolutely.
Because skills is required for all the 40 students.
Right.
And then some may go for research also,
yes.
For further students.
Yes, yes.
No, I think that's a wonderful idea. I think you are essentially saying that you will like to filter out those students who have a genuine interest in kind of science. Let me tell you that this is being done, like for instance, I know of Sivanadar University. They have a program for science students. They would they have some sort of an aptitude, sort of a test or something through which they identify students who are interested in research. And then they are actually assigned lab sort of, you know, associateship with some professor who is doing who's doing experiments, etc. So that's a wonderful thing to do. I also know of even language teaching. I know of one college in Bangalore where they do a kind of a initial screening of students of their English language, and then they kind of, you know, sort of classify them into three. So ones who are really good in the language would be really given to comparative literature, you know, some such interesting higher order literature study. And then the ones who are, because very often in language teaching, a standard methodology always make one section kind of, you know, be feeling left out. So the you know, they have A, B and C. So category A would be given very intense language skills, whereas C would be given literary skills. So these are all interesting pedagogical experiments if we can do that. I think that's equally applicable to science. And the other thing is that I don't think research is a very universal skill. That is also very, you know, even if my viewpoint would either be this, if a teacher says that I am very good at teaching, let me be a teacher, I think she or he should be given the freedom to do that. It is not something that everybody would enjoy doing. You know, some people are happy in that performance of teaching, isn't it? Like going to the class and, you know, doing teaching well. So I think it will also be very erroneous to try to convert everybody into a researcher. I think it should not be done also. Yeah.
Which institutions in India offer opportunities for full-time research? And after PhD and BBA, then what if something wants to be a full-time researcher?
Very few in social science. All the ICSSR institutions are largely full-time. I don't do anything other than doing research.
That's what I want to know, because when you say 2 decades of research, how
yeah.
is it possible?
It's that's the only thing I did, other than an interlude of about 7 or 8 years of teaching. I do 24-hour research. But that is available with ICSSR institutions. But at the same time, all of us are handling 5 projects at the same time. So it's not easy at all with different differing deadlines. So there are challenges of that. But at the same time, it also gives you these occasional kicks, you know, like you also on high sometime. But other than Indian Council of Social Science Research Institutions, and there are other institutions which are slightly up, like there's an Observer Research Foundation, ORF. Which I understand is perhaps an Ambani Institute, I don't know, I think he has a big stake in that, because, you know, it's a huge strategy kind of a research institution that is there, it's a full-time research. And there are a lot of these foundations which have come up where largely by political, they have all their own political leanings too. They're all full-time think tanks, you know, a lot of think tanks. So they are the only, in fact, we are also perhaps facing a little fear, we also are afraid of a little axing from maybe a HRD would be one day wake up and say that what are you doing, you're not doing any socially useful. Not only socially useful, you're also doing a lot of disturbing activities, you know, like criticizing, critiquing, writing against, you know, questioning.
we talk a lot about academia industry interface.
Yes.
We call experts from industries to take sessions.
Correct.
Industry take our students to various industries.
Oh, sure.
But when we talk about collaborative research with industries, what is your take on that? And how can we collaborate with industries?
But I don't think industry would be interested in you if they do not see a benefit of collaboration. So that way it's a dicey kind of a thing. But if you're able to kind of offer value, they may come on board. And second thing is that a lot of things they may not even want you to know. Why should they collaborate with you? India is not a land of ethical business anyways. So that is also another constraint, isn't it? Like, you know, I'm telling you this because they are actually doing a case book kind of a edited volume on social enterprises in India. Morning, a lot of, you know, discussions was happening on social enterprises. This is steered by Tata Trust. Tata has a new trust called Vivek Vikas Anvesh Foundation. This is the newest Tata Trust. Their purpose is promoting development research. So one of their projects now is to study about 12 social enterprises in India, and we are writing a management challenges of that. So about 12 of us are participating in that. So that is actually a collaborative effort in some way. One is Tata's name would sell. When somebody, you say that you come from Tata's, people are extremely happy that, you know, to open their doors in front of you. They can see that there is some
association. And I hope that we each one of us gained something out of those. Now it's time to open this forum for some more intimate and interaction. So one by one, I would like to request each one of us to open up their mind and their ideas, and possibly they can speak about what is their interest and what and in which way they would like to be associated with any of the thing which they have mentioned, our both the guests. What is the clue that they have taken from their talk? So may I request with Sini ma'am first to begin with, and then we'll proceed from this way.
Thank you, Ritvik sir, and thank you to our guests today for sharing such useful insights with us. Sir and ma'am, we were thinking of some research projects, but the major problem came when we were talking about gaps. We were not able to find the gaps because we think about a gap and we go to the net and we search something, we see that it is already implemented. So we are again back to square one, we have to start afresh. So we thought of a project to implement in this area of Madhya Pradesh. The idea was to provide education to the marginalized students. And we thought of implementing this using an interdepartmental project research proposal we need to put forward with that. But when we saw the net, this scheme was already implemented in Karnataka. So we are way backwards. So my question is, can we put up such a research project which is relevant to our state, although it is implemented successfully in some other state of India?
I don't think if it's a if you consider that work or systematic research in the area of education, especially school, primary education or school education, not higher education, is a really burning issue in Madhya Pradesh, it should not deter us from going ahead since Karnataka has done it. Because you know, the way in which novelty is also defined is contextual, isn't it? So, if it is relevant to I think as researchers, maybe we are interested in designing, developing a proposal that suit the needs of Madhya Pradesh. It must have been done elsewhere. It should not be a deterrent at all. I don't really think so. That's a very wrong notion, because you know, knowledge is itself is very cumulative, and aisa hai to ek education study ke sath pura education research khatam ho gaya hota. It's not like that. You know, there are in research there is a need to confirm, affirm, reconfirm. So, you know, that's your, that's what as researchers we do. It's not that we jump from one area to the other. Education is a vast area. There are innumerable issues coming up on a daily basis, isn't it? So if you have, suppose, Karnataka or maybe in Madhya Pradesh itself, people must have done studies on education. So it will be very, very difficult for us to find out a completely uncharted area. That is not a researcher's concern at all. Very often we do research to just to confirm certain things, or we do research to differ with some other views, isn't it? So sometimes we concur, you know, like with others. But our desire is to maybe if you think that project would have also led to an action component, wherein the school would have designed an education approach, you know, an approach to education, then your research would be very different. You would like to have a proportional distribution of sample kind of, you know, people from all districts or the districts where you want. And maybe you would have actually also have very creative things of pedagogical sort of a thing, evaluative research components in that. I see it as a wonderfully, kind of a wonderful opportunity for us to introduce a lot of creative methodological elements to maybe some of the results would really kind of, you know, support what others have found. You may actually find new things, you may explore new terrains, etc. So I don't think, none of us is looking for a brand new uncharted problem. No, I am still interested in, I think then I spent about 15 years of my life only looking at microfinance. I should be very ashamed of it, but I am not, because I think I have learned various aspects of microfinance. Sometimes I was looking at policy, sometimes I was looking at practice, some other kind of, you know, occasion I was looking at financing patterns, maybe some other time I was looking at impact. So, you know, and now I have rejected it. So I have also reached a stage when I don't want to look at it anymore. So that happens with all researchers. I don't think we should really look for virgin areas of research. That kuch bhi nahi hai.
There's
all the reason for you. Maybe you can bring in elements from Karnataka's success story, if it is a success, or if it's a failure that you have not done. I would say I would then do a research study where first I would look at Karnataka experiment, the status of that, you know, what led to that experiment, and you know, what went right and what went wrong, what I can learn from it, and then I would like to kind of, you know, put it in the context of Madhya Pradesh and say that can these things work, or I need to really do something else, because you are taking something else and putting in a different context. You know, that juxtaposition may not be very automatic, isn't it? So it's a wonderful thing. That itself could be a proposal. You say that we have seen this happening in Karnataka, but Madhya Pradesh has much severe problem with respect to education, and Madhya Pradesh needs this. And also, Madhya Pradesh also has an equally good IT history, recent IT history.
Interdepartmental.
I would say that you should go ahead, because in Madhya Pradesh, as far as I understand, the IT revolution started with a big bang. You are one of the pioneers, but we lost steam in between, and now we don't know where is it. So if you want to reclaim the power of IT, I think this is a very good way of entering the space.
Again, coming back to language, no virtual classroom still exists in
Hindi. In Hindi, yeah.
Yes. So people are thinking if you could do something about that.
I think you should go ahead. Anything to do with education, my 3 votes for it. Because we are very poor, we have completely neglected education as a sector, whether you talk about primary, secondary, higher education, anything. We are not interested in education anymore. At least we, by mean the state. So somebody else should take it up. I think just go ahead. That's my.
Anyone else?
Sir, this is a question. For Ganesh, the Department of Social Work is looking for a manufacturing unit at a central jail. Manufacturing unit is a sort of a startup, and we are planning to go for a namkeen unit at a central jail. Can we go for as a startup, or it comes under that incubation cell, this activity?
What I could
there's a business already running.
It's not.
And what, under what category does it come?
This comes as a startup, or it's, we can collaborate, we can take it into as a incubation, so like.
Sir, department is in dialogues with the jail authorities, and there is a Department of Social Work, and they at our college, and they said that there is a possibility. They have hinted that you can have an activity on for the welfare of the inmates. So, for example, they gave a lot of examples. So, can the snacks preparation unit or something like that? So, his question is pertinent.
You can just do it. I don't see a problem with doing it. It need not be part. I mean, you can register it as, or you can claim it as part of your incubation activities in this institution. But it can be done elsewhere. It need not be based in the campus. So you can run an activity elsewhere, guided by people here, and it can be claimed as an activity from this institute. But it can operate elsewhere. That's not a problem.
The manufacturing unit will be in central jail itself.
So you can run it there, and it is part of your incubation activity. That's okay. Yeah.
Sir, as a proposal for solid waste management in the campus, like recycling of the papers, small unit, which can be also managed by some students, can it be an incubation activity?
Yes, you can. See, any activity which is of commercial value can go under the incubation activity, under the for-profit part of it. If it's a social venture, it can go under the non-profit, not-for-profit activity. So, if there is more interest in the not-for-profit, then you can probably start with that. If there's interest in the for-profit, you can start with that. But I don't think you need to make a choice. Whatever comes along, whatever is initiated by students, whether it's for-profit or not, can be supported. So that's what I would suggest. And you don't need separate facilities. The facility remains the same. It's just that the company may be for-profit or not-for-profit.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am, this is a suggestion from you. I'm actually a background of digital electronics and then management. So I have my complete thesis on IT development in the state of Madhya Pradesh, concentrating more of Bhopal. So I've studied the entire IT policy of the state, and it was an awareness of the youth. And I was actually trying to find out, what is the youth aware of this growing IT sector? But then I found that the youth is not aware. Then I came out with a model of we need to start up at the school level. So right now, my concentration of my research entirely is only IT, growth of IT, concentrated in Bhopal city. And now right now I'm taking a paper on what are the reasons of migration of the youth from Bhopal. So am I at the right track? I mean, like, you know, because it was a craze for me to understand why the youth is leaving Bhopal, though the government is claiming there's a lot of growth in the IT sector.
You are linking the IT
related research to youth migration. You mean to say that despite the growth of the IT sector, that's what you mean? Yeah. Is it, and I don't know, that you have proven that IT sector has grown?
That I have done a study of last 5 years.
Okay.
I find there's a lot of growth. But awareness among the youth is not there. They actually not able to discover the IT is happening this much in the state of
MP. When you say IT is happening, what do you mean by that?
Ma'am, actually I have done a study on the entire IT services on the state.
ITES. Okay. You mean to say that ITES is growing fast, but the youth are leaving. But are you sure? No, I think one of the research questions would be, who are these young people who are leaving MP?
I have targeted my entire sample of two different groups. I have the youth category also. I have the middlemen who actually want to settle in Bhopal. I have another category who doesn't want to go out of Bhopal.
Okay.
Because they are at the age of retirement.
Right.
And I have a crowd who find a difference in the change happening in Bhopal. That's my elderly.
Right. But my question, I ask these questions because I would say that, you know, that question of yours, that is why the youth leave Bhopal, can also be irrespective of
or independent of the IT story.
It is.
So I thought you were making a kind of a compulsory connection between the two. Otherwise, it's an interesting, because youth migration is a very important area of research, you know, right now in India. And, you know, a lot of work, global bodies like ILO would be extremely interested in this kind of a study. You know, like several, you know, you may find several organizations, especially in India, we talk about this kind of, you know, demographic dividend and youth-centric things and all that. So I think a lot of people are definitely worried about youth and the patterns of youth kind of development. So it's a very opportune, relevant sort of a research question, you know, like youth migration. Definitely. And in my MBA, I don't think, I have never come across any study about youth migration.
Yeah, I can just add that there are youth who are not interested in the ITES services because it's required to work in the night, and they are not able to manage that. But ITES companies have found it useful to employ people who are near retirement or post-retirement. For these same jobs which were given to youth are being given to people who are post-retirement, and they have found that it makes a big difference. It is a very positive difference because the older people are far more mature, they are more patient with the, you know, the youth might get angry, but you know, this fellow doesn't get angry so easily. Even if the other side is shouting, they will calm them down. So the older people on the same job, and they can work in the night. They require to sleep less, you know, so they are okay with working in the night. So this has actually made a big difference to some of these companies who have tried that. Of course, it may not be uniformly good, but it's a way of looking at this whole sector differently. Startup seed grant is given only if the business plan is seen as worthwhile, sometimes institutes give it, but it's not very common, because what it requires is the company has to be funded by somebody else. So what is typically done is that if an institute is giving it, they give a stipend to the entrepreneur who is starting a business till they are able to run a profitable business. So it's like a stipend given for 6 months. So you may be given 20,000, 30,000 per month for 6 months. You can take it as a salary and you start the business. That's what is typically done. In terms of seed grant, in IMP, we have a seed grant of one lakh. That is what is given. You can get a 1 lakh grant by just writing a one-page proposal. But what is required at the end of that, if you use the money, you have to say what you did with it. And you can use the money to put up a larger proposal which is funded by the government grant or an international agency. You can do that. Or you can use that 1 lakh and, you know, get a paper out of it. So it's up to you how you use that grant. But what we have as a rule is that unless you complete a grant and, you know, report about it, you can't get the next one. So maximum a person can have one grant with them. If they don't use it, well, they can't get a new one. And they can't, so it's sort of restricted that way. And it is, in IMP, we don't use it for buying books and all that. For that, there is a separate faculty development allowance. So that is what we use for buying books or any such thing.
Can you incite something about linkages and difference between these two? Linkages
between?
And the collaboration.
Between what?
Linkages.
And the collaboration.
Where? From our institute?
In general, what is actually inside?
Yeah, so IMB has a fair number of collaborations happening. Only problem is that much of these collaborations are initiated by individuals, and you know, they are not necessarily institutionalized in the sense that others are not involved. So somebody in the institute may get into a collaboration with somebody from some other institute. As long as they are there, it is happening. Once that person leaves, the whole thing collapses. You know, so we had one person who had a great interest in dealing with medical related research. So he started a number of collaborations with different people, but then after some 5 years he was in IMB, then now he has moved to ISV. So all the collaborations are now with ISV. They are no longer with IMB. So that's the problem. I mean, much of it actually moves because the central person has actually moved. So unless it is multiple people are involved, the collaboration may not work so well. That is what I have found. We have other thing which is, we have student exchanges which you also have. We have, along with the student exchanges, we also encourage faculty exchanges, but it may not happen. Faculty exchange happens when somebody calls you to do joint research or you go there to teach. Those type of things we have encouraged, but only if the faculty is free for a certain period of time, they are able to do it. So many faculty find it difficult to manage that sort of time to go elsewhere for 2 months or 3 months, you know. So that is what, much of that has not happened, so we have agreements for that. So every time we sign a student exchange, we also sign a faculty exchange. But the faculty exchange doesn't happen so as much as the student exchange happens. So these two things are there, and of course locally we have some arrangements with Indian Institute of Science. So we have, for example, Indian Institute of Science students coming to our classroom and studying with our students, which has happened. But our students have not gone to Indian Institute of Science for studying there. So some of these things have become a bit uneven because their students are interested in attending IMB classes, our students are not interested in attending ISC classes, so that's the issue.
I think the difference between linguistics, I think it is also quite important in the sense that, you know, maybe you...
Very often we use the different terms to perhaps refer to the same phenomenon, you know, like... But if I really try to find a kind of a technical difference between collaboration and linkage, collaboration to me is more dynamic, it looks. There is some exchange happening. You know, as he says, in the sense that exchange may completely be unseated at some point in time, but there's an exchange of some sort of there's a transaction happening. Linkage could be just a kind of, you know, I am linked to, there's a linkage relationship with maybe Ministry of Rural Development, you know. It doesn't, it may not result in anything, but I know that we have a linkage, we have a link with, you know, a particular institution, a ministry, or, you know, some sort of a thing. But there may not be any actual transaction happening. That can be dormant for a long time. You know, suddenly it may really come up and get operational. But you talk about collaboration only when something is actually, some real values are actually transacted. You can have linkage for several, you know, you can derive several values out of it, like, you know, linkage for resources, linkage for, you know, like intellectual sort of kind of resources, kind of money, that kind of capital. Linkage for several resources ho sakta hai. But I think a collaboration is still a very dynamic, you know, I think it could be kind of a, how do you say that, it may be footloose in the sense that it can go away from you. But it's also possible to have institutional collaborations. For instance, some of the projects that GIDR does with a complete contractual understanding that if the person leaves also, the project would stay with us. So like somebody has gone and joined IIT Tirupati, his project is with us, but the project has not gone with him. So he suddenly became an external consultant to the project remains with us. Because there is already a kind of an agreement done in terms of resource flows, and, you know, GIDR is the management, you know, resource management agency, the money will come to us. So some of the collaborations, difficult to break. But if an individual is involved, there is always a threat of the individual really sort of fly by night, but then it's all gone.
About the journal part of it, I just want to add, so we have started what is called a student journal, which essentially when students do projects with faculty, so faculty are guiding projects for students, so faculty are invited to mention or suggest projects which are done very well. So if I have guided a project which has gone very well, or maybe it is my idea which students have implemented and it has worked very, I mean it has been written well, so what I can do is I can suggest that particular project for our online journal. So it's a completely online journal. It's there's a website for it called Tejas, and Tejas, that's, if you search, you will find that place. And then what happens is the best of these papers are reviewed by a faculty, in independent of those who have guided it. Another faculty look at it, and then the student is invited to write a short paper, just 2 or 3 pages, on what they have done and what they have, what results they have got, and that gets published on the website. And it's an interesting thing because whenever my students' papers have got published there, my name will also come in that, but as a guide. Okay. But what happens is sometimes industry people look at, find that, and then they start inquiries. You know, and specifically the students have gone. The students are there for 2 years, they have gone. The faculty is still there, so they catch the faculty and say, I want to know more about this, and so on. So sometimes that can lead to interesting outcomes. So it's a good thing to even project your students' work. Plus, it of course gives you some visibility also.
Yes, sir,
programs have a dissertation component?
Yeah, so something of that sort.
There's a dissertation component.
It's not something that is, once you publish there, you can't publish it again. It's not like that. It's a very short summary. It just tells you in 2-3 pages what the work that person has done. You can always publish it. It's not something that prevents you from publishing. So you are basically required to write a summary. That's the way.
Maybe I think since
you know, it's maybe kind of another example which I suddenly remembered. When I was teaching at MICA, my PhD was in the economics of media. I really studied the Indian newspaper industry. So that's what took me to MICA for about 3-4 years to teach economics of media. Then I left it. But there was a very interesting institution. MICA's MBA program has a very solid component of dissertation. But they had a competition. Best dissertation award, and they managed to get the money from TAM. TAM is a television audience measurement agency. And by the time I left MICA, about 4 such kind of organizations came forward to put the prize money for that piece. That used to be a wonderful sort of a thing. You know, there is a very intense student activity towards the end of MA because, and also it's very cutthroat competition too. They're all very competitive. Sort of a kids, you know, they will not let the other one really sort of rise their heads. So, but that led to great kind of, you know, at least 10 very good kind of, you know, the real top ones who want to compete in the thing. So that is also another little institution one could create, you know, best thesis or best dissertation kind of a prize, a departmental prize for the best dissertation. That also would be an incentive for the students to put in a little, more effort, and the faculty also. I think I know that it used to be our pride too. You know, my student is, number one, number two, like that. At least 3 of them have really kind of, you know, leveraged those proposals and gone abroad to do their PhDs. 2 of them, one is teaching in Purdue, the other is teaching in University of Chicago, Illinois. They all say that it is this particular practice which really instilled a kind of a research aptitude in them. Suddenly they discovered that, you know, research is also feasible within a mainstream management sort of a course. So I think it will be very interesting that if you start something like that, you know, wherein quality can be sort of assured. And teachers also suddenly will become very competitive. Student internship, etc. I think the practice is, you know, I think what is more important is for us to know who is relevant in our field. So we must know that in this region, Madhya Pradesh or Western Central India, which are the relevant institutions for us. I think that exercise we have to do. Somebody should spend time and find out who is doing research and, you know, like which organization is, who is working where. And then I think it should also be maybe an annual practice during whichever time you want. You write to some of these institutions saying that our student, that's the kind of request we all the time get. sometimes we get from departments and you know, institutions saying that they have Ambedkar University once sent about you know, 5 students, and that was a very interesting exercise. And Ambedkar University Development Studies Department is really good. You know, we got about 5 students in one go once, in the sense that there was a request from the university saying that we have students, about 5 or 6 of them, available for internship. Would you like to? So you should write to several organizations, not one. That is collaboration. Otherwise, you know, it becomes, you know, like it's a very narrow definition of, you know, I think you should scan this region and find out, you know, who is relevant. And MB has MBSSR. That's not a bad institute. In certain kind of exclusion studies and all that, it's a good place. There are good, if not the place is not good, there are good people. If you have any problem with the place, then you can always find good faculty members who are published enough and who have, you know, who can guide your students. You moved to Rajasthan, has Institute of Development Studies, and in Gujarat we have large number of places, including NGOs like Unnati, which is doing wonderful work in decentralized governance and things like that. They always have projects running in the field. They need interns. Anandi is another organization, area networking for development initiatives. They have a huge decentralization project going on with, I think it is Asim Premji Foundation, for 3 years, a multi-crore project. They need interns all the time. So you need to, maybe we can help you in terms of sending you the names of some of these contact names. And I think it's for the school to explore possibilities. And once you establish that is what DISS etc. does. You know, it became a name to reckon with by constant kind of, you know, interaction with the outside world. So don't limit yourself to one or two people, one or two institutions. Just sort of, you know, open it up. Wherever students can possibly travel, I think we should take all that. You should blindly write. I think somebody would be interested. Like, you know, most of the social science research institutions generally have people working in multiple areas: environment, natural resources, poverty, employment, you know, gender, feminist studies. You know, generally it's an assortment of skills and interests. Or maybe I want to work in an area, I did not have time to do the reading, maybe your student would help me in that. One doesn't know. So I think it has to be a great initiative. One person or one cell should be in charge of those correspondence and, you know, like finding out and things like that. But we can always tell you, you know.
It's important in this regarding the area of joint interest. Do you see any, suggest any area whereby we can have some collaboration with your institute from this college side, Madam? Any common area where we could join you or?
See, we are running some programs on entrepreneurship which we are trying to take forward to multiple institutions across the country. So in the first, this time we have run a program for women entrepreneurs, which was run, initially the first year it was run only in IMD. This year we have added a few other institutes, including some of the new IIMs. For example, IIM Vishakhapatnam, IIM Udaipur were involved this year. And going forward, we want to take this forward into many more institutions. So this is one thing that can be done. So the way it works is, like IIM Vishakhapatnam did the course for the local entrepreneurs from Vishakhapatnam region. They did the program, they did it fully in the Vishakhapatnam campus. And then the final 1 week, so out of those people, some were selected, and the ones who were selected went to Bangalore and did the final round there. So there was a 2 week program, I think two week program at Vishakhapatnam, followed by a 1 week program at Bangalore for some selected from Vishakhapatnam. So that type of thing we can definitely do if your institution is interested in running the program here. You know, we would give all the material to run the program. The program can be run here, and it makes sense because people from this region will find it easy to come here rather than go to Bangalore. But once they are selected, then they may be interested in going to Bangalore because you know, it is more prestigious. So then they are saying, okay, we'll make that, we'll put in that money and go for that trip. And that program in Bangalore is completely free. The program here may be charged, but the program that you do 1 week in Bangalore is completely free, only you have to pay for your travel. So that is what we have started. So that type of arrangement is definitely possible. Especially in the entrepreneurship field, we are looking at outreach as much as possible. Right? When it comes to research, it is a bit more difficult to do such things because most faculty are working on their own. They don't need too much of research support, or they are working with their doctoral students, so there is already some support there. And going out to do research, well, typically a faculty in IMP would go to their home institution, which may be in the US and so on, and work with their faculty there or their past classmates. So these are typically what the pattern I have seen. So it's much more rarer that we have people starting off collaborations. But what I have seen which works is if you have done something and you have completed the work but you still need some support to sort of get it in line with publication, then people have actually approached faculty and got it done. So somebody has worked and done the basic research, written it up, but it's not yet publishable. With a very little very little support, they are able to actually convert it into a publication. So that is a possibility. So that is easier for faculty out there to also do. If the work is reasonably well done but needs some additional work, then it's possible. So you can identify a faculty who's in your field and see whether you can get that happen. That I would suppose will happen with other institutes also. I'm just saying that type of thing can work. But if you say I want to start a project with you, well, it's very unlikely. It will not happen. Okay, we have all nod our heads, but we will not do anything. Okay. So essentially only if something has already been done, then there is a chance it will happen. With those initial startup type of project will typically happen with people whom you know very well.
The rounds of, the calls for project applications would open up now in UGC and UGC, I don't know what is the fate of it, but ICSSR would definitely start now. What you can really do is that whoever is interested in submitting a proposal, either individually or collectively, can work on proposals now. We can help sharpen the proposal in that sense, where there is ICSSR has what is known as a research program, which is 25 to 50 lakhs, which is quite good for 2 years. Generally, they ask for inter-institutional collaboration in that, or at least collaboration is encouraged. So, that is one site where institutions can come together. For instance, one study that I am doing right now, I have a collaborator in French Institute of Pondicherry, another one, Central University of Gujarat. Three institutions, about six researchers are collaborating and things like that. So, my point is the initiative should come from you. Some of you who are interested in getting your research funded, please go ahead and prepare proposals. We don't need to meet like this, we can remotely work in terms of really sort of commenting on it, sharpening it, methodology thoda work kar sakte hain. We can at least develop a clutch of proposals which can then be submitted to all these minor grants, major grants kind of a thing. Three or four such grants would actually make your research output visible. You can apply, I think you are submitted to different agencies then, you put it to ICSSR. ICSSR also has small grant and a larger grant program. UGC will also, if it comes with that, and then we can also pass on some of these. And then of course, I think I'll definitely keep it in mind whenever we have for a large, when we respond to a large research kind of a funding call, and we typically have participants across India. I would definitely look at, personally I would definitely look for if there's anything the school can, do. That promise, I can, as Professor Prabhu says, I can do that. and I'll definitely remember this place henceforth whenever I think in terms of collaboration. Beyond that, आप prepare कर लीजिएगा proposals, उसके ऊपर थोड़ा काम करके methodology वगैरह करके थोड़ा you know acceptable करके we can then at least two or three will get then funded. So that's the way to
exactly. So now, see what is important is not that we get a kind of collaboration or linkage with IIMB or your institute there out in Ahmedabad. Until now, they both were a kind of, I would say, aliens, unknown to us. But from the fact that you know, we have interacted for a complete day, now they have become apna. Ma'am has already promised that she would always, you know, envision BSSS whenever she thinks of some collaboration. And I'm very sure Dr. Prabhu now will at least dream some days about BSSS. He will forget his own institution and think of us. So, at least until he reaches home. So, it is more of a coming together and you know, getting to know, and even from the very fact that when we asked him whether he could be a member of our editorial team, I think that's what's important. You know, as he said, he must make a strong editorial team, simply means people from eminent institutes. Very simple. Instead of making one from Barkatullah University and one from, you know, Atal Bihari University and a third one again from Bhopal, we should rather spread across India and then slowly internationally. And this is, I think, a simple process than learning about incubation or, you know, research. I would say it was a group work and we have learned together and we have come to know each other. That in itself is a noble step. I, from my part, sir, thank you so much for making it. You know, he told us that he would not be able to come on a working day because, you know, the academic year has just started and then he wouldn't, I think, as a responsible professor, would bunk another day. And ma'am, we were very happy because, you know, this college is originally a social science college and it has a background. This college was initially started for the priest trainees. We have a seminary here, just across the road, and the seminarians used to be a major chunk here. Now it is a minuscule number, but then earlier it was a major number of 100 and more, and therefore the bishop then thought that there should be an institution where this the so-called would-be priests be trained for social work and social service. That's why this is named after, you know, the Bhopal School of Social Sciences, and later it continued for many, many years, number of years, and later, you know, it was spread to commerce, reading the signs of time, into management, and we were one of, not only one, the first institute to run MBA course in Bhopal, though we do not have it now due to technical reasons. The college by itself has a name, a stand in the city, and I think in the all of Madhya Pradesh. A university professor rightly put it, he said he went to Pune for a seminar or a workshop, I forget, and he said, when he said that he was from Barkatullah University, Bhopal, they did not understand, but they could immediately recall BSSS Bhopal. So I think it does stand in the market and also in the field of education. I, from my part, thank both of you. And we are happy that though a Sunday, we have worked towards a better world and prospects as our motto stands for. Thank you.
Thank you all for participating and allowing us for your valuable inputs. It's my honor and privilege to express our gratitude towards our eminent guests. To do this, may I invite Dr. Father John P.J. to present a memento to Professor Prabhu as a token of our sincere thanks, love, gratitude and appreciation. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, Father. May I now invite Dr. Sister Lissy Jones to present a memento to Dr. Tara S. Nair as a token of our love, thanks, and gratitude and appreciation. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, sister. On behalf of the entire BSS family, I wholeheartedly thank Professor Ganesh and Dr. Tara for their energy, efforts, and support. We are extremely hopeful and positive that with your support and guidance, college will go a long way. I now call upon Mr. Ritvik for extending a formal vote of thanks to take this program to the conclusion.
Thank you, ma'am. Although Principal, Father Principal John, Dr. John P.J. has already thanked both the guests, but being a part of formality, first of all, I would like to thank and recognize the support and cooperation that we have received from both the eminent guests, Professor Ganesh and Prabhu and Dr. Tara S. Nair. When we approached them, they were very, very much supportive and cooperative, and they took it very positively to our request. Normally, we were very apprehensive whether we will get any response or not, but we got response, and not only we were responded very positively. So very thank you very much. I extend on behalf of college, I extend sincere thanks to both the guests, to Dr. Ganesh and Prabhu and to Dr. Tara S. Nair. Then for the support and encouragement, I would like to say a word of sincere gratitude and thanks to Principal Dr. Father John P.J. and Vice Principal Dr. Sister Lissy Jones. It is their initiative, so they deserve a special round of applause for this initiative. And this vision, again, Father proves that he has a very great vision for this institution. Sincere thanks are also due to colleague in this process, Dr. Sudeshna Ray. She was instrumental in bringing people all the time. Also, she was arranging a lot of other things. So
I think she deserves a round of applause.
A round of applause to Dr. Sudeshna Ray. And late evening meetings, 7 o'clock onwards. So it was all part of this. And sincere thanks to the faculty members who participated in the workshop and expressed their views and opinions and ideas and are willing to take this mission forward. And support staff and anybody and anyone else who is associated with this, if I am forgetting, I extend on behalf of research cell and to the members of research cell also, the round of applause is required. So thank you very much. We worked as a team. So thank you very much. Thank you all, and we hope to continue the same process. Thank you.
Thank you.